Yeah. Danger, giants, battle is my story. But alone, I won't know. That's my glory. Shadows who cannot hide me. My king will fight. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Dubai fam, welcome to Youth Saturday Online. We believe that if we change the campus, we change the world. Yeah. I know you guys are excited to hear God's word today, but don't forget to invite your friends and your family and your classmates. No, everyone. Yeah, everyone. And also don't forget to follow us on our Instagram at ENC Campus Dubai and at Facebook. ENC Dubai, yeah, at ENC Dubai, yeah. Share the links to invite your friends and your family and your classmates, you know, everyone, yeah, everyone, so that they can also join us. Go, just go, just to go, invite your friends, yalla, go. From Carl and Sugar last time, but again, if you're a gamer or someone who's interested in gaming, yeah, like Valorant, Mobile Legends, Call of Duty, Roblox, or even NBA 2K, or you know, Switch Sports, whenever that's coming, yeah, okay. Or if you're into K-pop, K-dramas, or anything related to it, you know, fandoms, all that, yeah, you're not alone. We have a community just for you in this space, yeah. Type in a fire emoji in the comment section if you want to get connected. Yeah. Oh my God. Can't believe I clutched that. Hey, oh guys, well, what are you waiting for? Go invite your friends. Yeah, I'm totally not playing Valorant here. Yeah. Almighty, who wanted? I'm
the reason that I ask. I've seen far too many friends walk away and not come back. You want more than that. I won't wash away like branches in a rain. Rather be kindling in the light. Set me on fire like I've never known. I wanna love you more as life goes on. So all of my days I'll place my first love first again.
First love loved you first. This is Youth Saturday ASMR version. Hello everyone, my name is Ralph. And this is my cat, Kopi. And welcome to Youth Saturday. And, you know, it's February, and we're gonna talk about a topic that is your favorite, probably. It's about dating and relationships. I know, don't deny it, you've been waiting for this for a long time. But kidding aside, relationships, dating is a serious topic, and we believe it is something that we should talk about openly. Not just to our friends, but also to our parents, and also to the people around you. And I'm just going to show this conversation that I saw over the internet. I swear, it's it's from the internet. This guy is asking a question to his friend, and he says, "Bruh, if you have been praying for a crush, and the other day I read my Bible and it says, I give you a new commandment, love one another. Just as I have loved you, you must love one another. So is this a yes to dating the crush?" Asking for a friend. And I like the reply of the other guy. He says, "Bruh, fur." That means for real, for the mature, more mature audience that we have. It's for real, for real. What's for asking for a friend? Anyway, I just want to highlight the title that we have, because it's our topic for today. It's asking for a friend. Because, you know, we put that after our questions just to imply, not really imply, you're claiming to ask for a friend, but really, the question is for yourself, right? This is to ease any awkwardness or cringeness when it comes to talking about something that you are, you know, you're asking for example. Or, in this case, dating and relationships. But before we dive in, let us go to this verse and let us read first, if you can open your Bibles. This is in 1 Timothy 4, verse 11 to 12, and it says, "Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." Let's pray. Lord, I pray today that you will walk with these young people and reveal to them how to be an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and purity. Help us have an obedient and obedient heart and an open mind so that our lives will be transformed by you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so just a quick background of the text. Timothy was a young person who was tasked to lead the church. So imagine a young person leading different age groups. There are mature people, there are young people. And then Paul goes on to say, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. Right? Because when you're young, sometimes you don't get taken seriously. Because I've been there. I was not taken seriously because I was young. And when you and I don't get taken seriously, we end up not taking any responsibility for any of our actions. Right? Like anything you say or do, like, yeah, it's not going to get taken seriously. So you just do whatever you want to do. I remember I used to say, when people laugh about my bad choices or the things that I've done in the past, I used to say, I was young. It's like some kind of an excuse to myself that those decisions and actions didn't mean anything. because I was young, you know, but because of those decisions, people got hurt. But here in this word, Paul goes on saying, no, you are an example. You can set an example. The world is telling us that, no, you don't need to be an example. But that's not true. The truth is, you are to set an example, even if you are young. So before we dive in into how can I be an example, how can I set a right example, even as young as we are, since we're talking about dating, we're going to start off with a few questions about dating and see, like, how can we be examples in dating, you know? First question would be, what's the right age to start dating? I don't know. I dated at a young age, and I can say it was a bad idea. So I'll say 14. I'm kidding. To answer this question, I'm going to answer with another question. And this question is, what season are you in right now? Like, what is God calling you to be right now? Is He calling you to study? Is He calling you to work? Is He calling you to obey your parents right now? Because you see, God puts us in different seasons of life. But you know, sometimes we get tempted and distracted and move on to the different season that we want to be in. So for example, you are called to study right now. As most of you are. And then we get distracted by this attractive person and like, oh, I want to date this guy or this girl. And then you start moving on to a different season where you're not prepared for, right? I'll talk about a time in my life where I was in university. Looking back, God was calling me to study, to excel, and to just focus on studying, I guess. To learn more about what future is ahead of me, I guess. But I got distracted. I started dating, then I started failing my subjects. And then because I failed my subjects, I started lying to my parents because I don't want them to pull me out of school. You know, I was spending money that I didn't make to date. The money that was supposedly allocated for me to study. So I ended up not honoring my parents. I was in an unhealthy relationship. I was not honoring the Lord. I am basically sinning to God. So let me answer your question. What season are you in right now? And then there's another question that we get, like, how can I get out of the friend zone? This, I don't know, it's too cringy, I know. But we can answer this. I can answer this, I guess. How can I get out of the friend zone? You don't. What do I mean by that? Like, I'm married, and you know I'm married, but I'm still in the friend zone. How is that? Technically, I'm still friends with my wife. It doesn't mean that when you get married, you get to know the person you married instantly. Because what's your definition of friendship, right? To me, being friends with someone is to getting to know someone on a deeper level, you know, having real conversations without trying to impress them, spending quality time together without any awkward pressure. So if you think this is your definition of friends, like having fun, you know, going through life together, then I'm still in that friendship phase with my wife. So why be pressured, you know, to get out of the friend zone if the friend zone is where the best place you could be, you know? And also, let's get back to the first question. If this is the season where God calls you to be friends with the person you like, then why not, right? So when you're in the friend zone, rejoice. And then there's this third question, like, why are there so many rules to Christian dating? There aren't many, are there? Okay, so I give this an example because I drive. I don't know if you can relate, but hopefully you can. So if I am to drive in a road that doesn't have any rules that was put in, then I can create my own lane. You know, I can just drive into another lane and then go past the other lanes. Won't even stop maybe on a red light because I'm rushing. Wouldn't even slow down on a school zone or an hospital zone, you know. Those kind of things. I just can't imagine the chaos that I would bring or the accidents that will happen because it's not just me that's driving, you know. It's like if I am a broken person and I'm going deep diving into relationship, if there are no rules, I might bring those brokenness into the relationship. So, just like a parent not wanting their child to run into the street, God's guidelines are designed to protect you. But that, not just you, also the people around you. Okay, my cat is... Please excuse my cat. That's why God gives us rules to prevent us from encountering pain and heartbreak. Who is better at writing instructions than our Creator, right? Looking back at my relationship with my wife, I thank God for these rules because it helped me not cause emotional or even physical hurt to the person I want to be with. And this helped me honor him with my relationships. So, how do I honor God exactly in dating? There's this verse in Romans 12, verse 1 to 2. And it says, I'm reading from ESV. Paul says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable, and perfect. Let's just cut, or like, let me rephrase what Paul meant. How do I honor God in my dating or in my relationships? It's by, when you say presenting your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, you're entrusting God the things in your life, the daily things in your life. You're sleeping, you're eating, you know. Those mundane things, you entrust the Lord. So that's what it was meant for. So even your relationships, your plans for the future, you entrust it to the Lord. And that is considered your spiritual worship. Or in other translations, it says, this is your true and proper worship. And then it continues to say, do not be conformed to this world, like to the patterns of the world. Do not follow blindly to the things that the world tells you. but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. God wants to transform the way you think about relationships, you know? In this case, about relationships. And that you can see and that you will understand. And if you're willing to be transformed by His renewal, you will see and understand that God has this good and pleasing and perfect will for you. It says acceptable here in ESV. So how do I honor God in my dating? It is by entrusting your relationship, your dating plans to God and letting God change the way you think. So that in turn you can see how good He is, how pleasing and perfect His plans for you are. I have this story of a friend. Okay, that friend is me. I dated at a young age, yeah, just like what I told you with those questions, right? And of course there were wrong things I've picked up along the way about dating. Because I didn't follow Christ before. And even though I was following Christ, I have brought those with me. So in turn, I had unhealthy relationships with friends around me. I'm not gonna go into detail because it's I don't feel proud about it. I kept them to myself since I was not really open to talking about it to anyone, even my parents. My brothers, sisters, my friends, maybe a few select friends who I know will tolerate what I say. I knew it was wrong. Because the word of the Lord tells me it's wrong. I've been following Jesus. Yeah, I've been reading the Bible. And the word just, you know, talks about these wrong things that you're going to do. But because I did not want to talk about it, nobody knew what I was going through. But the thing is, God had a plan. You know, He revealed these dark secrets of mine and saved me from it. And then, not just that, He sent people around me to ask the difficult questions and reveal the things I've been doing wrong to myself. It's the God wants me to entrust my life to Him and then reveals, transforms my heart and mind so that I can see what His perfect and pleasing will for my life is. And the next thing I know, I now want to date the right way. You know, that's when I met my wife. I started opening myself up and talking about my relationship to other people around me, especially our friends here, dear Kuya Edward, to Jasper, to Jose, you know, those people around me. And because I wanted to start to try it, I put rules in place because I came from, you know, a bad mindset, a different mindset about relationships and dating. And now these rules are in place so that I can honor the Lord with my relationship. My cat is whining. But anyway, we started entrusting our relationship, me and my wife, to the Lord, you know. It wasn't a smooth sailing because, you know, there are still things that I learn and things that the Lord reveals to me and to her, I guess. I hope so. And then we let the Lord transform these nasty things or these bad things that we think about, or like we've brought in into our relationship, and let Him guide us through His good, pleasing, and perfect will for our relationship. Lo and behold, we are now married and soon having a kid to love and also to protect. So I will have the experience of being a parent and, you know, maybe trying to put rules so that my kid won't get hurt also in the future. So I can relate to God, you know, putting rules for us. And I hope you learned something today. And if there's one big lesson I'd like you to remember, is that value being in a community that talks about love, dating, and relationships. So when you're in a community that encourages you to entrust your relationship to God, and also a community that reminds you that God can transform your hearts and minds so that we can understand, so that you can understand, you can understand God's will for you, that it is good, that it is perfect, then we can set, you can set a great example, not just for dating, you know. It's more than dating now, you know. It's relationship to the people around us. And even setting an example for the generations to come. And I know it can be awkward sometimes. But I know, and I will pray, that the Lord will give you the courage and the boldness to be open about it. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your presence today. We thank you that you have given us the confidence and the courage to set an example to the people around us. Lord, help us to remind each other that you know everything that's going on our lives, and that we can entrust every plan that we have to you. Please transform our hearts and minds that we may be able to see your perfect and pleasing will for our lives. Once again, Lord, thank you, and we love you. Amen. I hope you got something from that, and I hope to see you soon, guys, because we miss you. Bye.
Thank you so much, Kuira, for sharing that powerful message. I'd like to highlight the preaching where it talks about the importance of being part of a community, whether it comes to the topic of love, dating, crushes, or relationships. I really love that in this community, we have a safe place where we can talk about our feelings or our thoughts and, you know, just express ourselves about these certain topics. Now, going back to the verse we read in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." Yes, it's true. As young as we are, we can set an example to this world, to our classmates, our friends, but I love how even that we're not doing it alone. We have a community who will help us and guide us through our walk with God. I'd like to share a time where being part of a community helped me with my walk with God. There was a time where I wasn't the best kid, and I guess a lot of you guys can agree to me when I say that we've all done wrong things. But being part of the community, it helped me realize that if we do things that aren't, or like if we do things that aren't pleasing to God, we shouldn't do it at all. I mean, as young as we were, when, you know, we were still kids, we were always thought about the difference of the right things and the good things. But we just can't avoid to, you know, do the bad things. But what's important is that we repent on them and we learn from them. And we make a promise not only to ourselves, but to the people around us, and most especially God, that we won't do it again. Because like I said, if it's not pleasing for Him, then don't do it. Now, here are the two practical applications that we can do based on this preaching. So for the first one, among the questions we've discussed today, what question would you like to discuss more with your life group leader? Perhaps for some of you, discussing this in a smaller setup would be better to help you process things out even more. And you know what? If you have a different question that you would like to ask, or that we weren't able to discuss, you guys can share it with your life group. Now for the second one, who are the people in your life who will be there for you as you process all these questions? This is the beauty of being part of a life group. In fact, let me say this, it's more than just being part of the life group, but it's also being part of a community who you can trust and that who will not just be there by your side, but they will also help us with our walk with God. With that, again, please don't forget to follow us on Instagram at EN Campus Dubai and also on Facebook at ENC Dubai. Share the links to your friends or your classmates or, you know, to just anyone that you feel like should attend so that they can also join us as well. Before we end, let me just share a blessing and prayer for all of us. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us this time today to share your word and to listen to your gospel. We want to thank you that you help us, you know, be part of a community that we know we can trust and can help us with our journey with you, oh Father God. We thank you for all the blessings that you have given us, for the people that surrounds us, that's helping us change and be better for you every single day. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen. See you again next month, ENC fam. Bye. I hope you guys learned and enjoyed today. You raise a higher. You raise a higher.